everyone for joining us this evening. Before we start off with the panel discussion that we have planned today, I just wanted to take this opportunity to introduce myself, set some context, and share a few housekeeping rules with you. My name is Trina, and I'm a part of CAIF, the Circular Apparel Innovation Factory. And as most of you know, CAIF is an industry-led platform with the mission to build the capabilities in the ecosystem for India's textile and apparel sector to transition to circularity. CAIF, along with Sankalp Dialogues, presents the 9-week series of collective learning on a range of topics that we'll be covering. Structured as short-duration convenings, both in person and virtual. Sankalp Dialogues are in-depth discussions, capital connects, networking opportunities around local challenges, especially in light of the COVID crisis. With the background of the COVID crisis, CAIF, coming together with Sankalp Dialogues, has launched the series that we all have, you know, joined today. These are community-led learning, storytelling, and sharing sessions, so I'd urge you to keep this interactive. Over the weeks, as I mentioned, it's a 9-week series. We touch upon various aspects, ranging from fundraising to human resource to any other challenges entrepreneurs might be facing during this crisis. Today's session, as you all know, is focused especially on fundraising in a post-COVID world, along with our session partner, Avishkar Capital.
Hello, everyone. I welcome you to this session. My name is Divya Gupta, and I'm a part of Avishkar Capital's investment team, and I'll be the moderator of this session. We have a very interesting mix of panelists so that we can get perspectives from various angles. We have Shamik Rakshit. He's from Pi Ventures, which is an early stage tech fund. We have Sushant Bhatia from Caspian. He's from an early stage debt fund. So he will bring to us the perspective of a debt lender in such scenario. Then we have Utkarsh Sinha. He's an advisor and he works extensively with a lot of early stage founders, understands their perspectives, their problems very closely. He's from Bexley Advisor. Then we have Shashwat. Shashwat is a senior investment manager from Avishkar Capital. He has a lot of experience, not just in Indian early stage startup ecosystem, but also in Southeast Asian context. So if any of you are from that geography, and we know a lot of CAIF partners come from those geographies, he'll be able to answer and give you perspective from that angle. So this is our panel. And we'll jump right into the panel discussion now. So my first question to all the panelists is this. How do you think early stage investors are responding to the current crisis of COVID-19 pandemic and its economic fallout in the short term? And what do you think will be the more irreversible long-term impact of this pandemic on the startup ecosystem due to changing perspectives of investors?
Thanks, Divya. Thanks, Kev. Thanks, everyone. Thanks, Avishkar Capital, as well, to welcome me to this panel discussion. So, for me, when we are receiving, definitely we are receiving a lot of deal flows, and we are seeing that how the deal flows are currently looking. The most important thing we are definitely, the step is more cautious for us. We are going. If I want to say, we are looking more vertical than in a horizontal space, where we are looking, where we want to see that, okay, the startup that they are pitching, that are pitching to us is has more momentum behind them. There are certain traction which is already there. We are looking into the SaaS space, API driven. This is probably the space that we are looking at currently, as far as the short term is concerned. If I have to say long term, I'm not sure how long will this COVID will be there, and obviously with the discussion more is on the post COVID scenario. So the impact is we are looking at something which is non-contact based, more which is into the, say, telehealth or more into the digital app space. These are the areas we are more focusing on at this point in time.
If I can just fill in from Avishkar perspective. So one of the things which has happened is that, there is a usual engagement with the portfolio companies you have, but since COVID has started, that level of engagement has deepened a lot, because as you are aware, any investor will like to protect their assets to the extent possible, because he or she is fully invested in that asset. So a lot of the mental bandwidth of investors has moved towards protection, the value protection part from their existing portfolio. And hence, the new deal evaluation bandwidth has also kind of gotten affected by that. And hence, I think a lot of your early stage proposals, you may be experiencing lags. Even from some of the most prompt investors, you would see that, you know, the kind of response times you were used to getting, it is coming down, because everyone is trying to fix their house in order. But having said that, once we are out of the depth of this crisis, hopefully everyone will know where their situation is. The profit and loss related damages or the balance sheet damages would have been incurred, but we will have much more new opportunities emerging, and there is enough dry powder out there. The good news is that a lot of funds were closed at the pre-COVID arena itself. So you will have a lot of participants actively looking for deal pipelines. But I think that is my reading of the situation right now.
Thanks. Sushant, it will be interesting to get your perspective as well. You coming from the debt fund background.
Yeah. No, I completely agree with Shashwat. The entire focus, you know, for last 3 months went on to, existing portfolio. That was the first port of call. Suddenly people have become much more closer to their portfolio companies, much more than usual interactions are happening. And so we, you know, in our debt portfolio itself, we have 90 active portfolio companies. And it's a significant portfolio, you know, compared to peers and industry. So, and that too, in different sectors like agri, healthcare, education, wash. And so we, really took time to understand the impact it had on each one of them. So I would say roughly, around 15% of them had a positive sort of impact, but the majority of our portfolio, 80% plus, had to bear the negative brunt of it. So the entire focus, went there. In fact, a couple of term sheets which were in final stage also were put on hold due to COVID. And that's the story we have heard across. So yeah, that has happened. Very recently we started evaluating, new opportunities, because I believe, the opportunities for investments will be there more. And even the funds, they will start investing sooner. My hunch is ticket size might become smaller, across stages, but the funding, will be back even from debt perspective. The good news is people are, more focused on profitability and, sustainability. Unit economics is back in fashion. So that's great news for us.
Thanks, Sushant. Utkarsh, from you, I would like to know, given that you're usually a bridge between investor community and the founder community, how do you think the way investors are evaluating will evolve? And what are the key tips or takeaways you would give to founders on now rehashing their startup pitches?
I think, there's a great quote that Howard Marks often uses, which is that, history does not repeat itself, but it does rhyme. And I think, it's pretty true in this situation right now, where, it's a very typical post-crisis kind of an environment that we are in, where people who have the pockets, deep pockets, even those folks are skittish right now. And I think there's a general attitude of wait and watch, which goes back to the point that Sushant made, that a lot of term sheets which were, on the verge of being offered, on the verge of converting, have also been put in the icebox. So, if you're an entrepreneur right now, there are two or three things that you need to watch out for. One, do not try and come up with a solution just for the crisis. The story that you have, the story that is yours, is much more credible than anything that you can come up with right now. That said, you need, to, you know, plan for what changes given this environmental change that is that you're in. So that's point number one. Point number two is that, you know, you will have to, you know, if you're going to market right now, you are going to have to be ready for the fact that A, it's going to be a much longer battle right now. People are going to take longer to engage. The thresholds that people have to cross to make an investment decision are going to be higher. Therefore, you need to have more of an appetite to stay in the game, which means you have to be very lean, you know, which means that you have to make sure that your costs are very much in order. And therefore, you have the ability to outlast the other person and therefore be able to be in that position where you can take a check when somebody is willing to write it. So, you know, going back to the point again that Sushant made, unit economics is something which is going to be extremely critical. The pathway to unit economics, at least, is going to be something that you have to be very, you know, conscious about. And lastly, I'd say that this, you know, you try and explore alternate models. You know, this is not the time to just, you know, go to the sources that you knew. Your hustle is what's going to make you win. So, you know, you have to knock on every door and make sure that you're able to get a few responses. Once you're able to get some traction, that traction leads to a lot of conversion. So there has always been a reluctance, you know, to write the first check. That reluctance becomes a little higher in an environment like this. Therefore, you have to work very hard to get that first check, which will, you know, kind of lead to a capillary action of other people following.
Thanks, thanks, Utkarsh. From the investor's side, how do you think your thinking in terms of evaluation has changed? Any points to add over and above, you know, the pathway to unit economics and profitability and getting the first check on time? Apart from these, do you think any other changes you're seeing in how we as investors are evaluating companies now?
I think some sectors obviously have shown some degree of prominence lately. So digital proposals in education technology, you know, things which are last mile delivery has certainly started to find favor. So a lot of these things are expected. What whosoever survives and whosoever faces the minimum revenue dent is likely to obviously be seen and heard, at least in the short term to medium term. But having said that, I think opportunity wise, the opportunities are across the board, and everyone, I think, whosoever I've talked to in the investor fraternity, I don't think anybody is saying that it is the end of this or it is the end of that from the pre-COVID era. Maybe, I mean, there is a small fraction of business models which may need a serious revisiting. But other than that, people are talking about pivots, not necessarily, you know, a whole sector becomes or whole substream becomes meaningless. That kind of knee-jerk kind of reaction, I don't see happening. So that's my take.
Yeah, thanks, Shashwat.
I just want to add something here. I just had a very interesting discussion with one of my colleagues probably 2 days back, and they were saying that, you know, the way we are looking at companies is, I mean, all this early stage, the VC is putting in money. They want one of the top line to grow. For this, all the startups, the growth is the primary prerogative here. But nowadays, the thing that we're looking at is, you know, when the company will start generating profits. Previously, it was probably at a Series B or a Series C level. Then, since when we would like to see the company generating profits. But the paradigm has shifted, and it is now probably at a Series A level when we are expecting the companies to generate certain profit. So this is something that is probably very early, but it's still changing that we see in the pitch decks, and we would like to pick the pitch decks to have something of that sort. The second thing that we have also seen is probably the way how we are going to price the products for these startups. I mean, previously it was more, you know, to get yourself established in the market and everything. But nowadays it is more seen like, okay, you price it the way you want to do it. I mean, you put your margins in and everything in, put your margin and then sell the product to the market. And then we'd like to see how it goes. So, yeah.
Thanks. Thanks, Shamik. All right. The other question we keep on hearing from founders in informal conversations, not informal ones, is that, are you going to press founders for tight valuations? Because this has become a buyer's market. So how do you think valuations are going to move? What kind of fall are you expecting? Are you expecting any fall at all?
I'd like to take that. I think one should expect that, you know, there's going to be a correction in valuations, not just because of the fact that, there's a crisis. I won't say that it's a cynical approach. It's more a function of the fact that I think valuations had started soaring beyond what was reasonable, and they were due for a correction. And this, you know, this kind of a market event causes that correction to happen. And right now, the mental hurdle to make an investment is higher for a number of reasons. And therefore, you know, valuation is something which is going to take a short-term hit. That's my view, and that's what I'm also hearing in most of the conversations that we're having. I think one of the factors that's also affecting it is, you know, there was a big SoftBank factor which was driving up valuations. You know, you had the comfort that if you're going in for a Series C at, you know, 6x the value that you would have been comfortable in a Series C, then there's going to be a Series D that is going to be led by, you know, one of the giants. The evaporation of that money is also causing some skittishness in the market. So there are a number of factors which are causing a squeeze in valuations, and one should be realistic about the fact that, you know, especially in early stage, there is going to be, and again, at early stage, valuation is something, you know, which you need to be more flexible about. You know, you might as well own 100% of zero, or own, 80% of something which is large. So that conversation is something which every entrepreneur needs to have with themselves, and not try to think about the fact that when they're giving away equity, they're giving away equity from a unicorn.
Yeah, I agree. I agree with Utkarsh, actually. So early stage, I think even if you look at all the back and forth which happens on that, invariably things are still somewhat range bound. So I mean, if you look at it, 10% to 30% dilution, if you draw that kind of a bracket, most of the things will fall in that. And I think what Utkarsh pointed out is right, that if the momentum of fundraise is getting affected, that people who were able to raise money every 12 months earlier are unlikely to continue that kind of a momentum in terms of fundraise, it will have an impact for sure. Because earlier, if your company was able to get into the market and raise money every year or every couple of years, you felt somewhat more comforted by that fact that the market will set at least that whole value growth can continue. But if the value discovery happens less frequently, that is when you get concerned, and that is when you try to apply some discounts to value.
Absolutely. And also, from your perspective as an investor, you know, the opportunity for secondaries becomes, exponentially lesser in an environment like this. You know, earlier there was an opportunity that, you know, 6 months, 1 year, 2 years down the line, you'll be able to at least liquidate some of your stake on a secondary sale. That is likely to come down, which is also going to, you know, make you think harder about, you know,
overall liquidity options come down, and hence it has a, and if you be realistic about that, I think right now the size of the check is something you should be really focused on, because COVID has really told us the importance of runway.
Yeah.
And I mean, these, although it's a one-off event, but being prepared, being 1 year plus kind of reserves, I mean, you can see this crisis has really made us appreciate that fact more than the promoter fully diluted shareholding. So we need to be very, very careful about that.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Thank you, Utkarsh and Shashwat, for that. So ultimately, the end result is if there's a mismatch in demand supply, there is less supply of capital to the investors deploying. So the price fall is going to happen. But I see a different perspective here, Utkarsh, that this could be a correction rather than a discount, a correction of a soaring valuation tide that we were having of late. So we can look at it like that as well. One question we've got from audience here is that how would valuation, it's a very specific question, but the question is how would valuation move in a pre-revenue kind of state or a or a proof of concept kind of stage. I would say that valuation at this stage is anyways difficult. Now, given COVID scenario, how would that change?
It's not straightforward at all. So obviously pre-revenue proof of concept valuation is something which is all about the product being ready and doing something in the market. So it's always future dependent. If the projections, it all links to the business plan, which is agreed between an investor and the entrepreneur. And I think as most of the panelists are indicating, that there will not be a very aggressive kind of business plan now, because earlier you have pre-product companies approaching that in 3 years, they will reach 200 crores, 150 crores in turnover. I think those kind of narratives are going to tone down. And if they tone down, they will have an implication on. So the way we approach is typically that if it's a pre-product company, how much stake can we own so that for the kind of risk we are taking, are we able to make the commensurate amount of return in 3-4 year time frame when the product is out there in the market and gets a historical P&L based kind of valuation. That's the only way I think most of the investors approach it.
Yeah, so just to add in here, what we are seeing is, in terms of valuation, there will be a steeper decline in, series B and beyond. And for early stage companies, there will be a lesser, impact on them, for example, pre-revenue kind of companies. Whereas mature companies, they'll see the impact immediately, in terms of percentage, it might go, 30-40%. Whereas pre-revenue stage, I don't really see a major, impact. It's as Shashwat pointed out, it really depends on the business plan. If their business plan is very severely impacted by COVID, then, of course, the valuations, will come down. But if not, they should not really worry at that stage about valuation.
The other thing that I'd just like to quickly add is that, the whole approach of, total addressable market and, trying to carve out a niche for yourself from that top number is something which will be challenged in times like this. And I think one of the approaches that we usually take with our companies is that, we take a reverse approach to that, which you call vector of accessible market, which is, where are you starting from and where do you go from there? What is your pathway and, how does, and, what are the timelines along that pathway? So I think, a bottom-up analysis and your, what are the critical milestones that you put in there? How thoroughly have you thought that through is going to be a lot more critical right now than just saying that, India is a, 1,300,000,000 population, just missing hamara 30% over. So I think that, pie in the sky is going to be a tougher sell right now. Whereas if you were able to demonstrate that this is our niche and we are going to grow from this niche into these areas, and that is why our revenue is going to go from X to 10X, that is going to be a lot more valuable.
Yeah, I agree with Sushant as well. The early stage valuation probably is not going to be as impacted as well at the later stages. And I would always suggest, whosoever is going for a very early stage, proof of concept stage, bring out the impact of any impact that the COVID has brought to your business. You be upfront about it and talk to the investor about it. I'm sure if there's a proof of concept, you must have spoken to some of your customers. You probably were on the verge of doing a pilot and then suddenly just got deferred. So bring those things out and I'm sure the impact will be there, but not that much.
All right, thank you. So these times, the anxiety levels in people are also soaring high, especially in founders, where on one hand, there is tight liquidity in investors, so they are not getting investments easily. And on the other hand, their revenue numbers are facing huge headwinds due to fall in demand due to various reasons. Now, in such times, promoters who are under so much pressure might make some mistakes. So what do you think are some of the mistakes which founders should be wary of and should be, aware of and avoid?
One thing, Divya, immediately comes to mind is, which I think Shashwat also mentioned and Samik also touched upon, is trying to hide or show a lesser impact of COVID on the business model. And that's really not, which is really not true. Investors are really, really aware of the massive impacts that the business models have taken. And one thing is, be open about it. Be really open about it. And what are the impact, and also what are the things that you're trying to do to overcome that impact. So be upfront, be transparent is what I would suggest, and not try to hide anything, because it's really out in the open, and everyone is facing this.
Thanks, Sushant.
So I also wanted to add there. So I think obviously it's a very, very difficult time period, and I think it wouldn't be right of me to say that this is a mistake or something, but some of the aberrations that I've started seeing is if the communication with the team has been wishy-washy or loose in terms of how the state of business is, I think as CEOs, the responsibility of an in and out know-how, and especially, earlier, if you were glued to the business to the extent that you used to visit something on a fortnightly basis, COVID was a time when you were supposed to do it every couple of days, and you needed to be the best guide for the company professionals who were working for you. So I think that aspect is where we have seen a variable performance across the portfolio. Some people have been very candid that, the hit is immense, and this is our roadmap. In this roadmap, everyone is going to take X percentage of pay cut. We are going to cut in administrative areas. We are going to cut in marketing areas, and people have been very crisp about their communication, which is great and which is generally widely appreciated. And in those instances, we have seen that the teams have really stood by those founders. And in fact, in some of the cases, the founders proposed a pay cut plan for a lesser number of months, but the team voluntarily suggested that you should reserve more capital for future. So, and in other cases, if we think that, the moment lockdown goes away, everything comes down very quickly, and we are very optimistic during this crisis period, it can be a very demoralizing factor for your team, because abruptly one fine day they see that your outlook is changing and you are being very fickle-minded about the situation. So I think that is one thing that I wanted to highlight related to this.
I'd like to second that, what Shashwat just said. I think this is the time for bold actions and quick actions. Dilly-dallying is not going to serve anyone well. It is the time to be, pessimistic in your planning, even if you're optimistic in your approach. So, you have to make sure that you plan for the fact that things are not going to go well and what you need to do to survive. Once you've done that planning and things go better, then it's always better to have a delta in the positive than a delta in the negative. So.
Thanks, Utkarsh. Okay. So we have a few questions coming in on business model. So a lot of founders are now quite confused on certain aspects. One of the aspects which I think we touched upon very vaguely in our conversation right now is that a lot of business models are going through some deviation or complete change. Company which started with certain objective and was on its track was suddenly met with a sudden drop in demand and started doing something else to just sustain, to just survive. Now, how do you think this will be perceived? Because on one hand, investors want great stories, big stories, ambitious stories. They want consistent stories. They want founders to be very, very clear with who they are and what they plan to do and have very granular details ready of their plan. But now all that is not sinking in with reality in the company at the moment. How do you think these sudden changes in business models and business idea will be perceived by investors?
So H1 2020, the way I see it is it's all about survival. So I don't think investors will overread the situation, what you exactly did within that. As long as you are able to come out of it with your core resources in hand, so you will hear stories in tech startups in Bangalore and NCR that they're trying to hold tight to their technology team, which has been with them from the beginning and are very, very key resources to them. So I think how you navigated the crisis, people are not going to extrapolate those measures in your future performance if they are being practical about it. That's my general sense. But having said that, it's not a good time in general. There is a lot of frustration going around. So I think you have to be very tactful, not turn up in the media for all the wrong reasons. So we just have to be tactful, stay low, come out of it with your core resources and have some runway so that you can come out of it stronger. That's the way I look at it.
Yeah, so survival is more important right now. Survival is the key and you won't be judged for surviving, whatever you do. Thanks. I think somebody had something to add.
Yeah, I mean, I feel, see, everybody, all the entrepreneurs have to be very smart here. Along with survival, I mean, it also has to be, there is a certain growth element to it. You just cannot wait on survival and just see out this entire scenario. What I would suggest is you probably have a core path to follow, but you can always take a separate branch without even changing your vision. I mean, you can always have your vision. You can change a little bit of a strategy, but not your vision for your product. And then make those, and definitely that, you never know, that will always, that can become a path to survival in this current times. There is no way you just can, hold on to your cash and, wait out to see how the scenario will build up. Because COVID, obviously, as we are all talking of this new term called the new normal, you never know how will things work out at the end of 3 months of 4 months down the line. And probably your product at that point in time might not be relevant at all. And probably the branch that you're working towards right now become more relevant. So it's always good that you have an alternative idea in your head.
Thanks. So one very specific question. What will be the next area? Whether product companies will be preferred going forward or service companies? What kind of impact will these two segments have? Which one will be preferred? This is an audience question.
I think the beauty of venture capital is that it's not a consensus business, right? And by definition, there are people who take diametrically opposite views of what's going to work, and that is the way that they make money. So I don't think there's any one answer of what is going to work. People are going to come at it from different angles. I think one thing in the short term is going to be that there's going to be a dip in discretionary spending, because everybody is going to be a little more cautious. Now, that dip in discretionary spending is going to apply as much to products as it is going to services. But in the long term, there is a tendency, after 1918, the Spanish flu, after 1929, after 1972, after 2008, there was a period of low spend. But it does revert to a normal. And if you look at most of the projections, India is projected to do a lot better than most of the large economies in the world. So if you're doing business in India, you are probably in better shape than if you are in most other places. So I don't think you should think about whether you should be in a product business or you should be in a service business. You should be in the business that you want to be in, and you should find the investor who's right for you.
Thanks. I think that addresses it pretty well. Another question from audience which has come, I think which you should address, Utkarsh, is how do they go about finding the right investment banker for them?
I think the first question you need to ask yourself is, do you need an investment banker? So, although I am an investment banker, I don't think that everybody in this world needs an investment banker. Most of the deals happen without our presence. So, if you, especially in the early stage, what really matters is whether you have the hustle and you're able to go talk to a lot of people, friends and families and their networks to get the capital that you need. Get connected with, angel networks, make sure that you are able to make a good pitch deck. Get the resources that you have in your family, friends, circle, who can give you honest and frank feedback on those material, and get it circulated. One of the biggest problems with early stage entrepreneurs is that they feel like, agar hum apna idea kisi ko bata denge, toh chori ho jayega. That is not how it works. Because very rarely is an idea in itself unique. What is unique is how you execute on that. So make sure that you get heard and you get in front of as many people as possible. You will dramatically increase your probability of success if you've been looked at by 10,000 people versus 1,000 people. And that is the only game that you need to play right now. Once you get more mature, when you're doing your Series A, Series B, that is when the reason an investment banker starts adding value at that point is that you have become very used to selling story A. You need to start pivoting and starting to sell a story B. If you get an advisor who's able to help you give that perspective, which you yourself are not internalizing, then that is becomes a lot more critical. You are selling an idea on in your pre-Series A or your seed round. In Series A, you're going to sell your execution. In Series B, you're going to sell your traction and your numbers. So those transitions become a lot more critical, and that's where an investment banker starts adding more value versus don't shell out cash to get somebody like me when you don't have cash in your pre-Series A round.
So Utkarsh, again, this fallout of this question is that then entrepreneurs who don't really have experience in raising capital, who don't know how to tell the right story, and they are in very, very early stage, maybe pre-Series A kind of stage. Hmm. How should they build up this knowledge base?
I think there are enough resources. You'll have to, again, I think I'll go back to the point. The only thing that makes an entrepreneur go from pre-Series A to Series A is that entrepreneur's hustle and that entrepreneur's execution. Right. So you will have to, knock on doors and, make sure that you get the advice that you need. You'll have to pester people because, unfortunately, at that point, there are very few people to whom you are attractive because you're part of a much larger crowd. And the way that you're going to stand out in that crowd is through your persistence. So, get help, write to folks like me and write to folks other folks who are like me. And if they don't reply to you, stalk them on LinkedIn, send them a message on Facebook, whatever it takes to get them to engage. And all they need to do is spend half an hour and an hour with you to look at your deck and tell you if they are in the right direction. They'll not be able to make your deck for you, but they'll be able to give you guidance. And probably if you really influence them, then they'll, share their connects with you as well. So all that matters at that stage is the hustle that you have. Don't look for a savior. You'll have to do it yourself.
And just to add to what Utkarsh just said, we VCs, early stage VCs, we prefer to talk to the founders directly.
Themselves, yeah.
Yeah, because it is to the founders that we are going to believe in, put the money behind them and all. So probably later stage, yes, definitely to investment banker.
Yeah, and even, no matter what stage an investment banker gets involved, one of the key facets that an investment banker has to have is a negative capability. You have to be the fly in the wall. You cannot be the center stage. So you enable people, but you are not going to be, speaking on their behalf. So, that is something which you will have to take center stage and be comfortable in the spotlight as an entrepreneur.
Thanks, Utkarsh. I think you made some very, very good points. And thanks, Shamit, for your points as well. Another thing which we keep on being asked is, what's the best way to reach out to investors? Because a lot of new founders have a lot of hesitation in just contacting investors. So what should they do? Shamik, Shashwat, if somebody wants to reach out to you, what should they do?
For me, definitely we like to consider ourselves very approachable, and definitely reach out to me on LinkedIn, write to me. And I'll share my email, share it with me. We'll discuss internally and we'll definitely get back either with a positive or a negative news, whatever it is, I'll definitely get back. That's probably the way to reach out. Yeah.
Thanks. Shushant, Shashwat, how should we reach you?
So I'll take this. So in my experience, I entered this sort of venture debt industry 5 years back, and I think and I met some early stage entrepreneurs, some of our friends who were entrepreneurs, we kept asking that question, and now I realize most of the investors are approachable. It really depends on the entrepreneur, that whether he or she has done their homework, whether it's a targeted message that you are going to send out, or you're going to send out a cold message that you will then use to send to 20 others as well. You have to really understand what this this particular investor wants. Do the homework, talk to multiple people even before you reach out to the specific investor, if you are really hell bent on talking to that guy. So really it's the background, it's the homework, and then you approach. I think the success rate is very high if you do that.
you cannot write it, going to his point, a dear investor letter is not going to work. It has never worked. You know, you have to be very targeted and focused.
So. Yeah, I think I concur with those points. And I think in general, direct inbounds are getting, most of the cases you will see that if you write someone on a LinkedIn page and people respond, people are quite responsive in general. But I think to add to the weight of your proposition, sometimes it helps if you're approaching through someone who is maybe a portfolio company founder or that investor. I mean, it just helps if you are reaching through within the networks of that investor. Also, like in job applications, it's always important to contextualize the approach. I mean, generally, if I were an investor, I'm let's say a healthcare investor, entrepreneur, then I would probably like to contextualize. I went through your website. I've seen that as an investor, you have done these 2-3 deals. And I think I would benefit from, understanding about the business model, something like that. So some level of context setting would also help why you approached, and as Utkarsh mentioned, please don't make it anonymous that, dear investor, here is the proposal, please feel free to add some context to it. I think humanizing things is always better in your process.
Thanks, Shashwat. So basically you can reach out to us through any way. An endorsement is good to have, but not a must have. It's in our interest as investors to find great promoters. So please don't shy before you message on a LinkedIn. The more important point here is how do you differentiate yourself, because there are 10 other people who are messaging in the same way. Meanwhile, we'll move on to the next question. How long does an early stage investment take from going to market to money in the bank? Typically, you can give perspective of your fund or in general. And how will this timeline be impacted due to COVID?
So I'll just jump in quickly. I think, it varies a lot by investor. Each investor has their own timeline. Shabik was just telling us about his. Each investor, once they decide to engage, might take anywhere from a month to 2-2.5 months to come back to you, conclude the due diligence process and come back with a yes or a no. But the first investor that you go to is not going to be the one who does the process with you. So you should typically budget at least 6 months for a fundraising process. So, and it varies by stage. And in this environment, I think that you should say that, that's going to get, impacted about 50%. So, when you think you need money in the bank, you need to be looking about 6 months before that, at least.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's a bit variable, but everyone tries to do their best in this because nobody wants to lose a deal while diligencing it. So it's not in the best interest of investor also to elongate the process. But sometimes there are some valid reasons for the process getting stretched, because sometimes you need to fix up certain elements, whether it comes to, regulatory aspects, or whether it comes to business specific tweaks or hirings, some critical element which may prevent the deal, or which may actually elongate the deal process. But 6 months is a good guidance, as Utkarsh mentioned, from first day, because you have internal processes, committee approvals, and then followed by some external due diligence. So better to budget 6 months at least. And if you are lucky, you can get it done in 3-4 months also. If your product or service is really, really enticing to that investor, and that's exactly something that that investor was looking for, that investor would like to move very, very fast and close it as soon as possible.
Thanks, Shashwat. So we'll take an audience question here from Sam Nicholas. His question is that I think he's in pre-series A stage. He's at a proof of concept stage. And his question is, for raising a seed capital round, does he need to have the entire top team on board by the time he goes to market?
Not required, definitely not. I mean, but should have a plan, and it is. What we usually prefer is you know, when you build a team, it is more that you are complementary to each other. Just do not bring somebody from the market and, you know, try to recruit somebody for an early stage startup. So you, it should be like if you're the CEO, somebody has the other capabilities of a CFO or a CEO, and accordingly, if both of the equation is good, only then the team will look good. So yeah, it is a gradual process. It is not like you send a recruitment, you start recruiting people on the basis of the offer, on the basis of their resume.
And also, I think the hiring decisions that you make and the team that you build are a reflection of your ability to execute. So it's very important that you're not left that question unanswered. If it is it's very difficult to get funded as a one man or a one woman show. If you are by yourself or if you've got a few people, the reasons for that are very important to enunciate. You have a plan, you had somebody that you don't have them, you're in the process of getting someone. Your thinking about that is more important than who you've got. The fact that you recognize that you're not going to be carrying the whole thing by yourself is something which an investor will see and take comfort in.
Yeah, and I think just to add to that, if you are talking about a 2-3 co-founder team, the complementarity which was highlighted is very important. If you're going for investor meetings, I think it should get very evident that people who are responsible for technology, business development, etc. If you have three people traveling with you, everyone should show those traits of leadership. I think that is seen very, very favorably by people. Instead of one person sitting and talking and the other guy sitting, you have to look for those leadership traits in the initial core team that you are developing. If you are handing over a particular department to someone, he should be of a credential who can actually lead conversations directly with investors. I mean, that is the kind of profile, that is the kind of entrepreneurial mindset you should be looking for. That while interviewing, while looking for co-founders, please be extremely cautious of that. I think that'll go a long way for your fundraise.
Thank you. The next question that we got is, in this time of social distancing, how do you think a founder can improve on its investor pitch and the entire due diligence process? Because the physical visits, physical meetings, etc. have gone, so that intimate physical presence is not there. How do they help investor take through the entire business plan model in a remote scenario?
So I think personally, I like founders who, there have been multiple occasions where founders have knocked on the doors on multiple occasions, but we have stayed in touch and there have been, so it's a good idea. Once you have formulated your investor connect, sharing periodic updates when you hit a certain milestone, I think warming up is in itself a very important activity, especially when people are remotely based and there are limitations to physical due diligence. Warm up, form connects, warm up people, give them periodic updates, give them a sense of the progress. And then if your business model requires on-site diligence, unfortunately, I don't see many investors who will be in a position to do closure of a deal without a physical diligence. But at least that will be one of the steps remaining, at least in their mind share, you would have occupied a significant position already. And once things are, more relaxed, they will probably choose you as one of their first due diligence visit partners. So I think that is how I would like to probably propose thinking about it.
I'll just approach this your question, Divya, in a little bit different way. I think we are in the middle of a deal and we were just thinking of doing the due diligence. So what we changed with this current scenario is we started looking at due diligence in a little bit different way, where we're looking at the stickiness of the revenue. We're looking at, whether there are any liabilities which are there, which are contingent in nature. We are doing more of a receivable audit, okay, whether they're actually receivable or not, considering that there is a period where people are trying to hold on to their cash and not paying money. So these are the kind of changes that we have brought into our due diligence process, just to name a few.
So to add one point, you know, this time also can be utilized by founders to build on, you know, better MIS sharing capabilities, better internal controls. This really, you know, gives the investor, you know, sentiment a boost in such times. You know, entrepreneurs have been able to put this time to good use, and you know, so that really sends out a positive message. So if you have been warming up to an investor earlier, and if you now share an update which is, you know, just more informative, that really sends out a great message even in the time of social distance.
Thanks, Shamik. You actually started answering the next question. And the last question that we had for you all, every crisis is a crisis, but it sometimes brings some opportunities as well, or some positive changes or opportunities to make positive changes. So what do you think are some positive effects of this crisis on startups and founders? How can they make this a positive crisis? And we'll end with this question.
Yeah, I mean, you're quite correct in saying, Divya, that every crisis brings a positive change. I mean, we have experienced this in 2008 as well, when there was a subprime crisis. And since then, we have seen some really good startups coming up, like the Instagrams, the WhatsApp. And it was probably the outcome of that crisis that those big Uber started after this crisis, right? So this is a good time. I think people should really think differently. I was just reading an article a few days back, and I saw that, you know, this COVID has impacted all sectors, all countries, everywhere throughout the world, right? So now we are all at, you know, status quo shift. When I say status quo, is we are at a status quo with all other countries. We are lagging way behind in US, in the startup industry, the China, and all of them, right? So now it is high time for all the entrepreneurs, and I shout out to all the entrepreneurs who are there. And there's that, you know, it's a good time for you to do an alternate thinking, think something big, think something which is very new. And I'm sure it will be the starting point of a new era for India. That's how I can say. Yeah.
I agree with Sumit, actually. So it will lead to more founders who were probably at the edge, and they realize now that, why not start something on our own? These are the moments which make a lot of people, prosper from being a employee to an entrepreneur. So that is one benefit of it. The other benefit of it is clearly in many of the sectors, if there was a lot of, you know, capital vandalism going on, of, you know, some players raising massive amounts of money, and the smaller players, getting questioned, why will you be even able to reach there? I think if some of those larger fundraisers get subdued for some time, the guys in the earlier stages of their journey will get a chance to actually catch up. So I think that is another positive that I see out of this crisis. It kind of democratizes the participation in many, many business models, where we were talking about monopolistic kind of situations.
Thank you so much to all of you joining us today. A special thank you to all our panelists and our participants. I think we got in a number of questions and managed to answer them.